Patrick. We just got played. This is Brian Fiore, and we're here with a very, very special cast and crew tonight. We've got a very diverse crowd. We have Carl Fenner from Common Man Games. We have game designer Don Riddle. We have what I consider to be the most knowledgeable person of existing board games. Currently works at Cool Stuff Inc., Eric Little.
And you got to plug it.
Wow. Well done.
This is Daniel, and I'm going to screw up his last name, Daniel Zayas.
Zayas.
So close.
He said on purpose.
Yeah, right?
This is Ken Shannon.
Howdy.
Game designer responsible for the upcoming Adventure Inn and many other games, including a lot of role-playing games. And I've already mentioned Ryan Fiore. So we're going to ask you guys a couple of questions tonight. We're going to ask some very serious game questions, and I hope you feel free to be able to tell us this. We're also going to ask some questions that are going to reflect a little bit more on your personality, some things that most other interview shows are not going to ask. If things get a little too sensitive and you get a little uncomfortable, please feel free to pass.
I'm feeling a little sensitive right now, but I would like to break that ice by asking Ken a question. Would that be okay?
I would love it.
Yes, sir. What would you like to ask me?
Ken, if you had to pick your favorite game that you do not have a damn thing to do with creating, etc., in what would it be? In what would it be?
Who wrote this? Is it like sausage or watermelon? What is it in?
What's your favorite game that you don't have a hand to create?
Oh, definitely Defenders of the Realm. I love that game. I love everything about it. I liked Pandemic, and I know that it has a lot of the same mechanics, but what I love about that game is it's got that American trash, like it's dice, it's always scary every single moment. You have to really work together. It's hard to do an alpha because an alpha player who's doing everything for everyone because everybody's got individual quests and their individual objectives. You really do have to work together. And I love that at the very beginning when I was playing with people who didn't know how to game, it took a long time to win. I love that with cooperative games. So yeah, definitely Defenders of the Realm from Richard Lanius.
Thank you, Ken. Patrick, take it away.
Well, I think we should use that same question on the rest of the guys.
That's a smart move.
I was thinking the same thing.
Oh, you're asking me.
Daniel, what do you think? What's your?
I don't know how often this happens, Patrick, but I'm going to ask you a question. If you had to pick your favorite game that you had
no hand in creating,
what would it be?
In what would it be?
In what way would it be what it was?
You can discuss the outer layer first.
The problem is there are so many games that I really do enjoy, and for many, many different reasons. But if you're asking me how I feel right now at this convention about a game, it's probably one that I just played very freshly that I really enjoyed. That's a good name. What game did we just play from this morning? Yesterday morning.
Chaosmos.
You
stole my answer.
I brought it to my game group. They were a little lukewarm on it, but I really like it.
I like it too.
I wouldn't call it my favorite. I wouldn't say that, but I think it's a great game.
It's my favorite because I played it 2 days ago. And
right.
The one I like the most of the content.
And you like new shiny things?
Yeah, I am new shiny.
Who doesn't like shiny?
Thank you, Patrick. Can I continue?
I would love for you.
Daniel, same question to you.
I'll have to go based on the con and something that's been published. I think Baseball Highlights 2045 is probably my favorite I played this
that's
convention.
That's nice.
Do you think somebody could like that if they don't like baseball?
I'm not a sports fan.
So I've been kind of like, I don't know if I'm
baseball. I know the rules.
Interested in that.
Absolutely. It's so back and forth tug of war with the opposite player. I played a two player, and then it was four players, so it was technically two player because it's designed to be a two player game. But you're going back and forth, hitting balls back to each other, and
it sounds like tennis,
but with the baseball.
As
a card.
Every round is essentially like an inning. Every turn is essentially an inning.
Yeah.
In a game, so it's just cool. It was. I played it with Ralph Anderson, who works for Eagle Griffin, our point spread was at the very end. We had to go extra innings, and I was 1 point difference, and I won. But it was tense. It built up amazingly, and it's got to be my favorite game I played the con for
awesome.
Sure.
Yeah. Excellent.
Yeah.
Just a little.
All right. Well, so I don't copy his answer.
It's actually a game. We played Chaosmos together. If that tells you.
We did. I don't know. I really did enjoy Chaosmos. We like the first time I played it, we ended up playing it like 3 times in a row because the group I was playing it with just really had a blast. I've taught a few other groups and it kind of felt I had a similar experience there. It seems like you either really like it or you really don't.
I think it's that you really understand or you really don't, because the problem in my group is they're like, we can't get weapons, and it was like, there's a bunch sitting in the cosmic pool. They're not, they don't say +1 or +2, but they're just as effective if you use them correctly.
Yeah. But no, I'd say here at the convention, a game that I've actually taught a lot that I really enjoy that I think like nobody knows exists is Dogs of War by Cool Mini or Not.
Love that game.
Typically, yes. I don't really dig Cool Mini or Not games because they seem to fall kind of flat a lot of times. Like they really focused on like just making the game cool looking, but there wasn't a whole lot of substance there. Dogs of War looks cool, but it's also cool. It's a really neat game, and it's a really solid Euro. It doesn't like overstay its welcome, because I mean, some Euros can really drag on. Really, I mean, AP really drags the game down. I even feel like AP in that game doesn't really drag the game down all that much.
I had a seller at the flea market today give me a discount on a purchase from him because I introduced him to Dogs of War last year, and he was so grateful.
Yeah,
it's awesome.
It's a fantastic game. It's got really
check that out.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah. Excellent. Dom.
What, Carl?
Should I state it again?
Please. What?
Oh, the same question? Oh, sure.
Stop leaning out of the shot.
No. I actually...
lean into it.
I was watching all these cool answers, so I'm going to give first my con answer. I'm just going to say my favorite game of the con so far, and that was Marco Polo. I don't know if you guys played it. It's brand new.
In the pool?
That was totally... I like
it was
that.
As if we're shouting across the room, and they're throwing pawns.
It's the board game version of...
No, it's called The Voyages of Marco Polo. It's a dice placement game, very reminiscent of Alien Frontiers, but not Alien Frontiers. It just was a heck of a lot of fun, and I'm just excited. I want to play it again. But that's my con one. That's not like my favorite. It's just my new shiny.
That's your shiny.
But if I actually had to answer that question, I would have a super cheesy answer, and that is Magic the Gathering. It's nice. Just a great, solid game. It has stood the test of time. They have managed to do 20 years of it or more and not screw it up, you know, majorly. And, you know,
that's
little
a ringing
skull clamp, you know, the little dark. What.
But it's just a great game. Great mechanic.
Well, but it's still there. If you want it, it's still there. So that's what's great about Magic. If you want to play with banding, go play with banding.
Yeah.
You know, it's there. So that's my cheesy
that
answer.
Question,
Magic Together.
That question should have said, except for Magic Together.
Right.
I just assume that.
Quick little game. It was a filler game, but a lot of times that's what the experience calls for. Sushi Go, I think.
It's a great game. Great game. A fun little game.
Played that a few times, and I was able to catch on. So it was...
Look in the mirror, Carl.
When I look in the mirror, I think Livingston.
Have you guys heard of this game?
No.
Yeah.
What was it called?
Livingston.
Oh, Livingston. Yeah, I saw you playing today. That's his new shiny.
That's my new shiny. Great, great game. Mechanics I've never seen before. And there's a particular part of it. You roll X number of dice. It depends on the number of people. But one thing that happens, and you sort of stagger them based from lowest to highest. And if you take a dice, let's say you take a 2, the next time you take a dice, you have to pick a higher dice. So you can't pick a 1 or a 2. And the dynamics are such that you can get screwed. It's actually 2 times the number of people. So we were playing with 5 people, so there were 10 dice. So in theory, everyone gets 2 dice every round, and everyone's smiley and happy. But there's ways to get these extra dice, and then there's ways to pick a dice that will leave someone downstream screwed. And it is such a great screw your neighbor game, and some guys were so brutally screwed, you know, that they just left the table. I will never play this game again. I hate this game. And I understand, because it was what if I went through what they went through.
But you won, so you loved it.
Exactly.
No, you're like, I have destroyed the lives of 4 men.
You know, that raises an interesting question. I don't have that written on a card, but it seems like modern people's opinion about gaming is everything should be good right up to the end, and some, you know, the fewest losers possible. But I still feel like deep down inside, you still want to feel some emotional connection. Even if you lose, I would like to be upset that I lost, not like, I didn't get enough victory points this turn.
I know what you're saying, but I think that's a conversation that's being held by the people that don't like Screw Your Neighbor stuff. But I think there's still a lot of great Screw Your Neighbor and tough, challenging, competitive games like Dogs of War that are being created that are still loved. Yeah. I think there is that conversation, but it is only half of the conversation. I don't think there's a real majority of either. I think some people feel this way, some people feel that way. They're not, nobody's right or wrong. It's just the way it is. If you like those types of games, play those types of games. If you don't like these, don't play those.
I feel like I'm seeing more of the I don't want to feel like anybody can pick on me games.
Like, well, like, but that's with the rise of cooperative. I think that's part of that. But cooperative games can be great, and the best cooperative games feel like the game itself hates you.
Yes.
You know?
The only cooperative games
I like being
are
beat
traders.
Up by a good cooperative.
Trader co-ops. That's the only co-op.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of that.
See, I like the co-ops with a timer.
Because then you get rid of the player.
I don't know. Like I've had this discussion a couple of times at this convention actually about cooperative games. I generally feel like cooperative games are kind of like a trivia game or a word game, where like a lot of people will walk away feeling dumb because there's one person at the table who's better at solving the math problem, because that's really what most board games break down into anyway. Is it's all just math with cool stuff on top of it.
Did you mean
you
to
had
say cool stuff?
I did not.
Are you going to try to work that in 4 or 5 times to get a raise? No, but every buck, every time you say
I'm going to brand a phrase.
it's like the cool stuff jar.
That's right. I just like to say every time he says cool stuff, I get a raise. Yeah.
But
that's what I'm talking about.
It's a drinking game.
No.
But the timer just gets rid of that. I like the stress. I mean, because it goes back to what he said. Like, I like a game where even if I lose, I felt like an emotional connection to the game.
Yeah.
That's where I find I have the most fun.
What's your least favorite cooperative game that doesn't have a clock?
My least favorite cooperative game that doesn't have a clock.
Or that you hate the most because it doesn't have a clock.
Oh, man.
Or do you really hate cooperatives, or you just rather not play them?
Pandemic? Well, I mean, honestly, I don't hate co-op. I'd rather not play co-op.
Yeah.
I found in general, Pandemic didn't really have so much going on for me. I like Flashpoint Fire Rescue. I feel like
that's a pretty fun little game.
Yeah, I feel like that's a really intense co-op. What, do you want me to say my least favorite is...
No, just like, say something about Police Precinct.
Jesus. You said stuff about
You know, there's this game called Police Precinct.
Police Precinct
which
is cool
amazing.
Stuff.
Yeah. Oh, man, damn!
There you go.
Oh, yeah!
He just dunked.
Fire. I would like to ask you what your favorite con is in LA. Your game convention. In reference to
Piece of Cake. Dice Town.
Why?
There's a lot of really great people that come here that I care about.
Not at this table, but there are some.
No.
Yeah.
This table...
Present company accepted.
Not really
as always.
So much. Not really so much.
Almost changed your opinion just because of this tape.
But it's the laid back environment and the engagement with gamers, and it provides to me a great opportunity to do a lot of playtesting of games that we're looking to release in the future. Other cons don't lend themselves too well to that, and
tons of prototyping. I see.
Ken Shannon, I'm going to ask actually several of you the same question, but Mr. Ken Shannon.
Yes.
I'm going to get to what everyone's going to watch this for is you've got some new projects and we want to hear about them.
You mean the prototypes or just the actual projects that are already like committed?
I want to hear what you are excited about and want to talk about.
Oh gosh, that's tough. Well, first, Adventure Inn is going along with Samurai Sheepdog, which is a company I worked with for role-playing games, and Gray Fox, which is an amazing company to work with, and they're really great, and they got some really great people in there that help hone things down. And it's come together really well, so how can you not be excited about the possibility of your first game coming through? That's absolutely fantastic. I also have another game called Attorney at Camelot that I'm probably working with US Games. I'm co-designing with Karen, I'm going to say her name wrong, Bogowski, I'm going to say it wrong, but that's her name. And she works with US Games, and she published Renaissance Wars.
Such a great person.
She's amazing. A really nice person. We work together. It's like amazing. Just cogs go right there. It's all good. And but outside of that, the one that I'm actually outside of the ones that I'm already pushing towards the market that I'm pitching, I have a game that was called a coven, but now it's called something else called The Witching Hour. It's funny because I designed a co-op game because I was irritated that there was always an alpha person. I was irritated that my people who hated co-op games were competitive players and they wouldn't play co-op games because I am the alpha male. I'm the alpha when I play co-op games. So I wanted a game where I couldn't be the alpha and where my friends who are magic players and hate things could sit down. So in this game, you're like a coven. I'm not going to go through it much, but basically you're a coven of witches and warlocks. One of you has done something wrong since the last year. So everybody gets a secret that changes how they play. But everything you do hurts the person to your left. So
You have to, if even one person dies, you all lose. But everything you do is me. So you have to find a way to balance. Are you going to get what you're doing done? How much extra stuff do you want to get for yourself, assuming that the guy next to you is going to help? And the funny part is, little decisions early on in the game, it's all math. Like, in terms of mathematically, it's all designed to be that it grows. So a little baby decision that might put a little extra pain on you early, well, now you have to compensate. So now you have to deal with it, and you have to deal with it. And by the time it gets to you on the last hour of the game, you're like, what the heck, man? Why'd you give that to me? But really, I was the one who gave it to you early on, because I was like, I want this extra spell. Here's a little bit of extra pain. So that's the game I'm like passionate about, and I'm obviously passionate about the other projects. I'm not saying that I'm not unbelievably excited about them, but you know, like right now it's the new shiny. I'm prototyping it, I'm setting it up. Yeah. But I love the idea that I finally have something that I really feel is not on the market. There's nothing there, and it's kind of got some neat little Carnival Ovation things in it. But that's the basis. Can I finally get a game where my competitive players sit down and they go, all right,
so
man, I'll play this.
Competitively cooperative.
Right. It gives you the feel of being competitive, and sometimes you like have to totally screw over your friend because your secret says you have to. If you don't, then the game, you'll lose.
Oh,
the whole team will lose the game.
So you don't have to complete it. Just secret objective.
If you don't, something bad happens at the end. So then you have to weigh the decision. Is it worth the risk that I'm going to screw everyone over with this, or do I go ahead and try to get this done with it?
That is cool.
So.
That sounds cool so far.
Daniel.
Yes.
You've got some big changes going on for the Meeple Mechanic. We just talked about a couple at lunch today. So what's the new shiny that's going to be on the Meeple Mechanic? On the game, the new changes that you plan on implementing.
The new changes. Oh my goodness, put me on the spot.
Don't timeline it because you don't want to get everybody mad at you.
No, I'm not timelining it. Not gonna timeline it. But so the Meeple Mechanic rates Kickstarter games or ranks Kickstarter games every week based on this rubric that took like 6 months to get honed in. But on the flip side of a Kickstarter launch is obviously how much money it makes at the end. So now I'm going to be working on tracking the end game. So how the industry is doing on a rolling monthly basis. So
are you going to compare that? Right. Like, mm-hmm. Are you going to compare that to its rank on your list in the first place?
Yeah. So I'm going to highlight games that did well in the first place, that made the Kickstarter Badger is the top 10 list. And then highlight those ones that followed the rubric and did well, and then also the ones that didn't follow the rubric and did well as well. So adding better validity, but also
but
improving the overall product.
What about the ones
product.
That follow the rubric but then don't do as well?
Well,
that's important information.
Sure. A lot of the reasons why a game won't do well, just in general, that I can't control, no matter how perfect the rubric is how well they marketed themselves.
Right.
That's just
not part of the rubric.
No. Well, there is a popularity in the rubric saying that how many backers do you have on the first week. So that is part of the rubric, but that still isn't a great predictor yet.
What about like Facebook likes and Twitter shares?
That's a loose thing too, because you can have 1,000, I'm not gonna name names. There is a campaign right now where the person who has made it, or the company that made it, has thousands and thousands and thousands of YouTube subscriptions and all this other stuff, and does not translate to someone giving you money for a product.
And it has not.
It has not, no.
It's easy to buy those.
It's easy to buy those.
It's easy to buy likes.
Sure.
Could you tell me how to do that after the video?
Yeah,
I want in on that.
Be careful buying Twitter followers.
A like is free, a like is free, and a backer is not. So, but the rubric is, it's almost like the market's opinion of what should fund. Based on what they want to see in campaigns, like a how to play video, or a rulebook PDF, or reviews from people they know, you know what I mean? So those are just some very basic examples. They want a free demo print and play. That's a smaller point scale that they get for it, but they want that. So, and I've asked a lot of people, and a lot of experts, and there's people want EU friendly, especially if you're in the EU. Like they want
that more and more. Yes, being a concern.
Right.
Yeah.
And publishers want to be EU friendly, and it's
and whenever
really
I,
hard
like, when
to
I've
do.
Met,
but it's,
when
but
I've
they,
met yeah, foreign yeah. folks at the con, that's something that they complain about is how difficult it is to buy American games.
Right.
Like, just like we want to seek after some Euro games that we're attached to and want to bring over, they're the same way. They want some American games that can be very expensive for them to get.
Unless you're in distribution.
Yeah,
it's like
trying to buy cocaine in Bolivia. It's a lot cheaper. It's much more expensive.
You know, it's a little bit like that, yeah. Would you talk into the mic a little closer about your cocaine?
There's mics everywhere.
There are.
But,
the whole place
Mr. Don Riddle, now, you have more games in your head and on paper and in your house than anyone I've ever met. And I'm very impressed with your ability to work on many games at the same time. So I'm going to ask you to limit all of the things you're working on. But I want you to tell me a couple of things that you've got prototype bouncing around and maybe some other stuff that you might have going on.
Well, the big deal that's on my brain right now is something that Carl is looking at right now for Common Man Games. It's a game, it's a cooperative game, sorry. It's a cooperative game about...
Does it have a timer?
Does it? Yeah, well, yeah, it does.
There you go.
An event
now you've got my attention.
And it's about... well, when I brought it to Carl, actually, it didn't really have much of a theme. It was just kind of a loose thing. It was more of just a game. But I thought it was an interesting game. And so through conversations with Carl, intense conversations with Carl about it, that it really excited me. We've got this idea for a theming of an internal affairs. So where Police Precinct takes place on the streets and you're taking care of all these problems in the streets, now we've internalized it and we're dealing with having to get dirty cops out of the precinct.
Cool.
And,
that is cool.
And we are the good cops. Excuse me, my darn phone went off.
That's the call you were expecting.
Was it? It probably was. I apologize greatly for that. I hope. I'm so sorry for that.
Don't worry about it. Just let it go.
Throw it over the bridge. apologize for that.
Look, it's filled with cocaine.
Yeah, I'm the bad cop.
I want. So yeah, so you work cooperatively, and if you know they can take over the department, and but we you try to jail them to win the game and solve cases in order to do that. So that's very much at the top of my mind right now. Very excited about it, you know, and I really appreciate again a reason why I appreciate Dice Tower Con is they're very interested. Every year they've been promoting these prototype events and these playtests and been very welcoming to new
so
designers. And,
nice.
Oh, the folks that set that up are just amazing.
Heather and Danica are amazing people from the Supguild. Yeah. Those are some of the nicest, most helpful people.
Specifically, the Supguild in Tampa really does an amazing job of helping people for no profit whatsoever.
No, they're
just
good
want to see great
people.
Games made.
So there's that. I have a little card game that I call Shadow Prophecy. That's about a primordial battle between light and shadow, and I'm working on that. And that's something like you know people ask me a lot. Just you know, folks, friends of mine that know I'm a game designer that you know I've tried to strap in the chairs and make them play test my games and stuff. they say, well, why don't you bring this to Kickstarter? Like Kickstarter is this magical thing. It's like I just throw a game at Kickstarter and suddenly it's published. And it's like that's I know that's not quite how it works. And for me personally. It's not how it works because I don't want to be one of those Kickstarters, the stinky ones that don't have anything to really present, and they're not ready, and they shouldn't have done this for another year at least, you know?
You guys from 4 years ago where it really was, let me show you an idea, what do you guys think?
Yeah.
Now it's, show me your finished game.
Yeah, that's true, I mean, it's where it's at, you have to admit it, you know, and you're not going to get noticed otherwise.
Because the big guys got involved, and they win.
Yeah.
So I think there's still room for the little guys, a few things.
Carl Fenner.
Actually, if I could.
You can't.
I would like to simulate a Kickstarter video from 4 years ago.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Is it mine?
No.
Good, then you can simulate it.
Okay, it's like this.
Hi, I'm Carl Fenner from Common Man Games. I've got this idea, and I think it'll work. So, back me. Thank you.
But you've come a long way since then, Carl.
That was way
too enthusiastic.
I got this idea. Way too enthusiastic.
That's the best.
Way too good.
Like 3 years ago, that would have been about right. Now 4 years ago.
How would I do with the rubric? Because it was less than 2 minutes.
I actually don't judge on the content of the video.
Okay. Like one of the things that would actually be like a 10. Like a top seller.
Yeah, exactly.
It just has a video. Carl's Kickstarter. Yeah. That's the whole thing. Just watch my video. Give me money.
I mean, there's plenty of people who say, like, make it 2 minutes. Make sure that you have half of it theme and half of it, like, a very light explanation of the gameplay. And then, like... but there's no rhyme or reason for what funds based on the video, except maybe the time if you want to talk statistically.
I saw some kind of YouTube, I don't remember who it was or what the show was, but they were talking about Kickstarter ridiculous projects, some of which raised $0. And then they also talked about one, like this guy who was making potato salad.
Yeah. That was a joke.
Potato salad.
I mean, he did it, but I mean,
right.
It was meant
joke,
to challenge
to
the format. It was an intentionally.
So here's a
thing.
Question: is that still active or is it history now?
Oh, that's history.
Oh, yeah, it's been.
Okay. Sent the potato
so
salad
at one
out.
Point, it was up to 50-something thousand.
Yeah.
Did, at the end, did everyone pull the plug because they were just kidding with their
backers? No.
He got
they paid it. He made the potato salad. He sent it to them.
Through a party.
Were the backers there to sort of like make a joke of Kickstarter? What were the backers thinking when they...
If you really want to talk about it, if he's really going to bring this up, we should talk about Emperor's New Clothes.
Yeah.
That's the real campaign that really challenged what is a Kickstarter campaign? What is it? Actually, what does it represent?
I actually talked with the designer from Geekdad.
Yeah, Geekdad.
And,
Jonathan Liu?
And I actually sat down with him and we played it. And at first you think it's a joke, but if you actually play the game, it's actually not. It's actually a game.
Yeah.
It looks like it's not. And you're and at the first you're like, yeah, okay. And all right, I'll just sit here and watch it. When's it gonna get funny?
But then you start seeing the
and then
things,
you start to recognize
when the acid that he put on the paper seeps into your system.
Yeah, no. Well, no, it's cocaine. It's white. Cocaine. Everything's white. We were
chewing on
you're
it.
Just like, yeah. No. Wow, this is great stuff. But yeah, no, but it's not like your head, man. It's red. So basically, that game actually was actually a real game. It was basically that when we started out, I would start to say that something was something. And over the game, people had to start to act like what it was what it was. So you had to actually kind of remember to some degree what was actually going on. And eventually it evolved by like the third or fourth moment in the game into an actual game that you were trying to solve and win.
But it was a game that was taking place in everybody's head,
right,
in their imagination.
I mean, the components, everything
I thought
was
that was
white.
Really interesting.
Everything was white. Like, it was just a blank card,
it was blank
cubes,
everything.
Blank everything. But, and I was like, and when he pulls it out, you're just like, I was sitting there with Robert Park and he was showing it to us, and we're both like, all right, man.
You know, and while you're obviously one of the people that got it,
right,
when it was presented as if there was nothing to not get. There was nothing to not get. Would it have been more sincere and less, I don't know, like the campaign almost felt snooty, right?
Sure.
You should understand what we're doing here. If you don't, you just see white components. You know, you must not have a fantastic imagination. And that's what it felt like, and I think that's why a lot of people had a problem with the campaign. They could have just said, hey guys, we got this great idea for a game, Emperor's New Clothes, it's only white components, but what you do with it is you use your imagination to create a game with our components. But they didn't go that route.
I didn't see the Kickstarter. I only played the game. So I have a completely different experience.
Well, the Kickstarter was invisible. There was nothing to see.
Okay.
If you were the end. Well, you know what I'm saying? Right. So what Jonathan did with that campaign,
cool,
by not going that way, is he was challenging what people expected from a Kickstarter campaign.
Right, sure.
You know, you expect a CCC and
great
no and no, no, no. But he was saying, no, what I'm selling you is an experience of the imagination. Are you willing to take a little journey? And I'm not saying either way, right or wrong. I'm just saying that's really the thing that the campaign. I thought it was an exciting campaign actually because it was so challenging.
Yeah, that's interesting, man.
Carl, back to the original question: what's Common Man bringing to the table? What are you saying?
Okay, well, Don brought up something that's important. It was completely unexpected. Prior to showing up at this con,
by either of us,
for Don and for me, and I really wanted to go to the 5-minute dating deal, and it was a good experience, and I met both you guys and others, and I did it last year, and it was fun, but I didn't remember making any great contacts, but this year, some stuff really struck a chord with me, so. I'm very interested in what both of us are doing, but I've been spending almost all my time working with Don on this internal affairs. And I was expecting to do other things, but I'm super glad that I went to that event, super glad that I met both you guys, super glad that we've been spending that time together. So that's a really big deal. And I've been saying to Don, that when I leave here, and he's sort of getting sick of me, right? I said, when I leave here, I'm almost gonna just completely 180, because when I get back to Denver, I'm gonna be starting a Kickstarter almost right away. And
what's that Kickstarter for? Talk about it.
That Kickstarter is for an upgrade to the first edition of Police Precinct. So when I get back to Denver, I gotta really focus on that and get ready for the Kickstarter. And once you get a Kickstarter started, I'll be checking in with you for that. Make sure I got the...
That's right. All the
max out that rubric. Max it out.
I'm going to max it. And so I got to prep for that. And then once you're in, it's nonstop. And then once you're done, it's sort of nonstop. So it's just starting
another
cycle.
And that gives me time to make the zillion changes you asked me to make to the game.
Do you have a date for that Kickstarter for the upgrade? Because I know a lot of people love Police Precinct.
Yeah.
And I know there's a lot of copies out there.
July 7th.
July 7th.
Yeah.
Nice.
So there were quite a few first edition copies that got out there quickly and early, and then it sold out. So it took a long time to make the work of art that the second edition is. So these first edition folks have been sitting there for a long time playing this great game and watching the development of the second edition going, hey, well, what about us? Like, don't forget about us, because I think a lot of game companies do that, or certainly game companies have a reputation for doing that,
right.
And I don't want to be that kind of game company. So this Kickstarter is all about the first edition people, and it's an upgrade kit, so it's giving them the parts of the second edition that I think make the most sense. It's getting them an upgrade kit, and it's also, some of them I know are going to just say, you know what, I gotta have the second edition. So it's gonna give them the opportunity to have the second edition, it's gonna give them an opportunity to get the upgrade kit. That's what it's about. And then I'm already planning at least the next Kickstarter after that, which is season 2. So we're treating Police Precinct as if it is a TV show.
And nice. I like it.
The base game is the pilot, and then the pilot of the entire, you know, sort of TV series, and then various expansions that have come out since are different episodes. So now, when we come out with second edition, sorry, that's like the beginning of season 2. So season 2 has already sort of begun, but we're going to actually have a Kickstarter that's all about season 2, and it's going to have 3 new episodes, and it's basically where you're sort of ripping things out of the pilot and applying new things. So you're going to immerse yourself in a different experience. So one of them is muggers, and you're going to be removing all the evidence cards and etc., and adding in all new components and playing a totally different experience. And jewel heist and the harbor, and we're kicking around the possibility of having internal affairs be a part of season 2. And it could be, I don't know how it's going to all play out. It's pretty far off. We think it's going to happen in January.
Sure. What's the game that you can't be beating?
The game that I can't beat.
What are you badass at, man? What do I not want to sit down across the table for?
Magic the Gathering.
Draw those codes like
we know it's not Tugs of War. I don't think I have lost a game of Planet Steam.
Why do you think that is? What do you think is your special skill that allows you to be so adept?
I'm not afraid to take risks in that game, and that's because the game time frame is so tight. You really have to commit a lot of things. There was one game I got a really super high score in that, I mean, I just threw all my money away in the first round, and basically, you know, like the second round I barely did anything, the third round I barely did anything, and I just flooded the market right at the end and made a ton of money and screwed everybody else out of making a bunch of money and did really well for it. I think a lot of people are just averse to taking big risks, like committing a lot right out of the gate. Because, really for 2 rounds I just didn't do anything. But.
And they didn't see it coming.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Big Dog Daniel, same question.
It's gonna sound smug. I don't lose a lot of games.
Man, dude, it's cocky.
I really
you're
this
right.
Con.
It did sound smug.
This I said I put
it's
the
like
disclaimer out
all the way.
I put the disclaimer out there. I haven't lost a lot of games this con, especially. Yeah.
Until today, I lost almost every game
really?
I played at this con.
I don't know what it is. I don't know. I got like the luck in me today. This con, but I haven't lost a lot. I won Cold Express.
Yeah.
One Siege of Verdanis. I won that
Not
one.
Not just this comp.
I won Coven.
Something that wherever you play it, you
usually
win.
Usually it's a traitor game that I'm like, and when I'm the traitor,
right.
That I pull out all
so
the stops.
Being
so
evil.
We should
I
not
celebrate
trust you. Is that what you're saying?
Being the dark evil person and like plotter. And
I'm a really good liar.
Really good at just putting on dumb face.
same question, Daniel. Though, why do you think that is? Is this a theatrical background?
I think
or
maybe it's maybe it is a theatrical background. I did. I mean, in high school, I guess I did some theater, but it wasn't.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I enjoy the dynamic of the mistrust, but like we're still having fun. It's just like the deception that might be happening. Maybe I watched too much. Like I don't know. TV about
something. So you like Battlestar? Battlestar Galactica?
Oh my goodness, yes, yes, absolutely.
We're going to find out at the end of this convention that there's not even a Daniel Zayas.
I am not
a scientist. And he's going to work with Pascal. He's actually the game designer.
He's,
right.
He's the Ken Shannon.
Yes. Same question, what am I good at? All right, so I got a family of gamers in my house, but they like casual games. So it's gotten to the point where like DC deck builders, you know, like Lord of the Rings. If it's a DC deck builder, I think maybe I can't think of a time that I've lost in the last year. It's just because you're so used to the game. It's kind of like, you know, you've rode the bike on this exact course 1,000 times, and now everyone else is trying to figure out how to ride.
The right card just glows. You pick it up. You know what I mean?
Well, it's just kind of it's like almost at the point where it's no longer fun. Like right. I just like when I play deck builder, sure. I almost make an effort to try to find strategy, but it doesn't matter. It's just kind of like because you're just so used to it. You know, it's almost like a mechanic than it is an actual like I'm so good. It's just
right.
I know what I'm doing all the time. And if you even make one mistake, I'm probably going to beat you, unless I get really unlucky.
Brian Fiore, ask a question.
Okay.
That's your favorite. My question is you. Can you ask a question?
In terms of a mix of luck and strategy, what would you say is a good mix or your favorite mix in a game? Like, you know, like for instance, chess might be, say, close to like 99 or 100% total strategy. Like, there's no luck. And what's a good mix? And what should go back around? It's a big for everybody.
Okay. Thanks for going. Make me go first on that. Let's see here. strategy and luck. Gosh, I guess there are a lot of games that do that now.
Sure.
I mean, 5-10 years ago, it was pretty much you had one or the other. I think, boy, you know, I play so many cooperative games. I know you guys hate them, but I like them for the opposite reason. Dislike them immensely. How's that?
I don't even dislike them immensely. I was learning some earlier today.
Look, that guy from Cool Stuff. We're in Fordo. Burning them for warmth does not tends to take it that way.
Why do you hate everything?
I'm trying to think. I can't come up with one right now.
You don't have to name a specific game, but like just the ratios.
I like games where...
Like a 50-50 luck strategy.
You know what it is? I hate games where you have high levels of strategy and then a single luck component, like St. Petersburg. If you've ever played that game, you can go the other way and say, okay, it's 90% strategy, and it just you're working your butt off, you got all this going, and then a guy flips over you know, this card in the one scene this one time, and since it's a Euro trash game, you're like, or you know, Ameritrash, Euro trash to me, it's like, oh yeah, okay, so everyone at the table has been doing it right, they're working really hard towards the collective strategy, and this one card flipped over, and we were an hour into the game, and this guy went.
Are you talking about St. Petersburg?
Yes.
No.
Daniel?
I like it when... I really like Take That. No one likes Take That, but I like Take That. And... but I like...
Take That.
Yeah, exactly.
Uh-oh. Let's not get it. No, we're going... If that keeps getting lower, we'll be like, enemies sacked out.
Yeah, exactly. One game I played today was Conquest of Sparrows, and that was one that I lost, as an example, and I really liked it, even... Yeah, even with losing.
Did you punch that guy that won?
No.
I thought you won everything.
Nearly everything.
You said nearly. You did say nearly.
Yeah, like, there's a few that I've lost.
Oh, no, we'd have to go back.
I actually lost Conquest of Sparrows, and I really, really like that game. It was it's one of those things where you every turn you do an effect that affects everybody else. But it still feels like you're making important decisions even with that happening.
So ratio of strategy to luck there.
It's got to be like right down the middle because you're still placing meeples out there that are you're making important decisions in that respect, but things still happen that affect the entire battlefield.
That you're outside of control.
That are outside of your control, and it's still it doesn't change my mind about any of the good things that I did in the game. So it's got to be right down the middle of strategy and luck. But it just I loved it. I personally loved it. Cool. Yeah.
Carl Fenner. somebody comes over. You're hanging out. They pull a game out of their bag, and it makes you cringe. What's the name of that game?
Trivial Pursuit.
Nice. Old
good answer.
That just goes on forever. It's so boring.
Sorry.
Yeah. I'm not a big fan of sort of family party games that have bad designs.
So you draw the line at bad design. You don't like those usually?
No, he likes bad designs, but they're family.
Yeah.
Daniel, if you had to club to death...
Oh my goodness.
Either a cute and fuzzy puppy.
That went downhill fast.
Or a defenseless baby seal.
Oh my goodness.
What would you choose?
I already heard Robert's answer. I'm just gonna. Oh man, I
can't reiterate his answer.
I have no. I'm not going to reiterate his answer, but I have to. I don't want to have to. I just wouldn't. I just accept the consequences of whatever
so
happened.
Die.
He clubbed himself.
The consequences are they
so he's
both
knocked
died.
Out and he couldn't do it.
Oh no. I'd no. save the puppy just because I like dogs.
Okay, that's fair enough.
Just because I like I have two dogs and they're awesome.
Ken,
yes,
this is gonna be a little personal, but do you, this is where you draw the line.
All right,
with illicit drug use, heroin is where you draw the line or no?
Heroin? No, man.
Oh, you don't draw the line at heroin.
No,
that's okay, good.
Deeper.
All right. Carl.
Let's talk after the show.
Okay. I got one for Carl.
Oh my goodness.
What is your spirit animal?
Ooh, I want to know this.
Yeah, I want to know this.
Gorilla.
A gorilla.
Gorilla.
Any particular? Silverback? You seem like a silverback man.
Diamondback?
That's a snake.
That's a rattlesnake.
It's a giant rattlesnake. Gorilla.
You mix it. You mix it in.
Oh, actually, it's a rattlesnake.
There you go.
Yeah. I was thinking gorilla, but no, it's rattlesnake.
Interesting.
Silverback rattlesnake.
Don? How about
that? Rattlesnake. It's like,
giant.
Oh, this is my favorite question.
Don,
by
same
the way.
Same question. We're
gonna
go.
A lizard.
What kind?
All of them. Yeah.
Lizards. Not a specific. It's not like I've studied lizards to understand
just like a friendly
that.
Little gecko?
Like a
more of a friendly little.
So like someone who's
like a chameleon aspects as well. Gecko aspects. Just the whole kind of chilling. Trying to figure out what's going on in this crazy universe, kind of a dude.
Eating flies.
Animal.
Does this lizard smoke pot?
Taking the fifth.
Eric Little.
I've had two people go before me, and I've been thinking about it since you asked it, and I'm not even sure what the answer is. Honestly.
Closed. You don't want us to start guessing, so come up with something.
It's one of those questions that the less time you have
a peacock.
Think. Right.
There you go. Yeah.
You are flamboyant. Big D.
Elephant. Elephant. I feel like I'm sturdy and just know what I'm grounded. I know what I'm doing.
You're gonna hunt you for your tusks. Ken!
I think it's a wolf. I just I like the
idea. Lone wolf or are you running with a pack?
No, running with a pack.
Okay. Please tell me you have a wolf t-shirt.
I do have a wolf t-shirt.
Sure it's not a gray fox?
It's close. It's like a friend. It's a friend of the fox.
What's your spirit animal?
Look
Patrick?
In the mirror, Patrick.
I would like to know that one.
I would have to say the baby seal that Daniel loved.
Sorry about that. I had to say the puppy.
You had to choose something. That's fine.
Right. It's like, dang it, that was mine.
So that's how it became a spirit animal.
I taught you about the birds and the bees.
Oh my goodness.
But not the flowers.
This is going to be a long story. Y'all better sit back.
Is there more tape in that thing?
I actually think I have an answer to that. I lived in St. Louis growing up, me and my two brothers, and I remember that my dad went to the library, or my mom, I don't know who, but my dad was the one who brought them to us. He had these albums, and we had a record player in my brother's room, but not just in his room, but in his back closet where the laundry chute was. And we turned these albums on and they were birds and the bees type things. And I think my parents just, no way do we want to deal with this. Just get these albums and Guy will be in charge, my little brother Guy. He'll be in charge of playing the albums. So I was probably in second, third grade or something.
We weren't recording here.
It was uncomfortable that she latched when she walked by. I was a little unsettled.
Oh
by
man!
That.
She's like, I'm gonna teach you.
But Carl and I will teach him many things.
American games are trash.
Oh, all goodness. Right. Well, I would like to say thank you very, very, very much.
Yay!
Thank you, Patrick.
Thank you. Thank you.
And this
Brian.
Is Patrick and Brian Fiore with Just Got Played.
Woo!
Cool. See.
What kind of production is this?